Hi everybody, and welcome back to Digital Integrated Circuits. I'm Professor Adam Teman of the EnICS Labs at Bar-Ilan University, and today we'll be going over the lecture called Other Memories. We have five parts to this lecture. We'll start with a very short reminder of the memory hierarchy, then we'll go over to read-only memory, dynamic RAM, non-volatile memory, and emerging memory. So let's start with an overview, a reminder of the memory hierarchy. Here is a schematic of the semiconductor memory classification. If we just take all of the memory arrays together, we can really classify it in several different ways. The one that we've kind of discussed till now is random access memory, which is here on the left side. Random access memory, as we discussed up till now, has its maybe most important branch is the read-write memories, which we often call just RAM. Random access memory, of course, is RAM, but other things are also random access as well. But what we usually call RAM are volatile memories. In other words, they only store their data as long as we have a battery connected, as long as we have some sort of voltage connected, otherwise they lose it. And what we discussed up till now was static RAM over here on the left. So static RAM is a type of a read-write memory. We can read from it and write to it, as we learned in a previous lecture. And it's random access. We can go and address any byte or any bit if we want to through word lines and bit lines, etc. The other very dominant type of read-write memory is what we call dynamic RAM or DRAM. And today we'll be discussing dynamic RAM. As opposed to static RAM, even though it's both random access and it is volatile, dynamic RAM stores its data on a dynamic, parasitic, or purposely put there capacitor, while static RAM, obviously, we learned has a connection to VDD or ground at all times, and therefore it is using static operation. So those are the main types of what we call random access memory. However, there is another kind of category of random access memory, which we would call read-only memories. And read-only memories, or non-volatile memories, which I'm calling them read-only memories, but nowadays they're not necessarily read-only. However, they are much more often read from than written to. And these are often called nowadays NVMs, or non-volatile memories. So that's the NVM category. And again, they're not really read-only or ROMs today, usually, but they would usually be categorized differently than standard RAM. Okay, so starting with mask ROM, which is the traditional type, which really was a read-only memory or a one-time programmable memory over here with the PROM. We will discuss that today. However, then you have the erasable programmable ROM or EPROM, electrically erasable programmable ROM or EEPROM, which are kind of defunct today. They're not used as much because of the dominance of flash ROM, which is actually a read-write memory, which we'll discuss as well. Other categories that we have in our classification are serial access memory, such as shift registers, you know, and then you can have serial in parallel out and parallel in serial out type of shift registers, or queues, which are usually FIFOs or LIFOs. And you also have a completely different type called content addressable memory that I will not be discussing in this lecture series, but possibly I will make a lecture about them in the future. As a reminder about the memory hierarchy of a personal computer, what we usually show is this pyramid, this well-known pyramid of the hierarchy of the memory. We have different types of memory that are categorized by several different parameters that can be shown in this schematic of a pyramid. So at the top of this, we have our CPU or our computational unit. It doesn't necessarily have to be a CPU. And whatever is closest to this tip of the pyramid is going to have the lowest latency. So this is the fastest type of memory. Unfortunately, as of now, the higher we are in this pyramid and the closer we are to the CPU, we also have the highest cost, or dollars per gigabyte of memory. So at the top of that, we have our CPU registers, which are really sitting inside our data path. They're almost always going to be flip-flops or some other type of circuit-based, but they're really going to be embedded on the chip. They're going to be right inside the data path, and they have a sub-cycle type of access time. But they're really expensive. As we saw before, you can take 30 or something transistors to make one flip-flop, one bit of data. So they're really going to be very, very expensive. when you go down to real memory, you get to what we call, you know, caches, the level one and level two cache, and then outer level caches, which would be level three and level four. So they're going to be primarily based on SRAM. And SRAM, we discussed a lot, it takes six transistors for one bit, which is also quite expensive. But then again, we are able to integrate it really well and make these push-to-roll SRAMs. They get a very tight layout, and we can get several megabytes. And even today, there's been demonstrations of over 100 megabytes of SRAM on a single chip, even though we usually talk about less than, you know, several dozen megabytes on chips that are really dominated by memory. SRAM is very fast, and we, deploy it in several levels of caches so we can reduce the access time to the different types of levels. But usually SRAM as an embedded memory in the same process as logic is really the dominant memory that we make up our embedded memory out of. There is also a category called embedded DRAM, where we can make DRAM similar to the one we'll be discussing in this lecture, but we can actually embed it on chip. Embedded DRAM is not as popular as it once was. Mainly it was driven by IBM in past years, but its scalability is problematic, so it hasn't been continuing as often. So at this point, we get to the end of the chip. That's what we call our embedded memories. They're embedded along with the logic on the same chip, on the same monolithic silicon. And then we have to go external outside of the chip. And as we go down in the memory hierarchy, again, our latency increases, so we get slower, but we reduce our cost as well. The real speed problem comes here because we now have to go off chip through, you know, external buses, through I/O circuits to a different chip that is integrated on the board or in the package or in all kinds of different ways. And our main memory over there is the DRAM, the dynamic RAM, which has to be fabricated in a special fab that will make these DRAMs, and there we can get really, you know, gigabytes on a chip or on a system on what we call a DIMM, or we can have a high bandwidth memory which have multiple stacks of these DRAMs, and you can get very many, you know, a lot of gigabytes of memory over there. And that is the main memory of our computer, and often when computer architects discuss memory, they are talking about DRAM. But DRAM, we discussed before, is a volatile memory. It's also expensive for many different reasons. And again, it loses its data after we turn off the power. So the next level down is what we would call secondary storage. And the newer kind of hierarchy here is storage class memory, SCM, which is based on different types of devices that have been developed in the past several decades and are currently really emerging out and becoming available in these years. So you have flash, BCM, MRAM, ReRAM, etc., which we'll be discussing later. And secondary storage, really NAND flash, has dominated this, making up our SSDs. And of course, we have hard disks, which, you know, the magnetic hard disks, they kind of refuse to die. Archival storage will be, you know, accessing through the network or something like that. So we get really a much higher number of cycles to access them. And we'll be usually using something like magnetic hard drives and tapes. And they may be, again, accessed through the network or really through a faraway server. So that's kind of our memory hierarchy in a brief nutshell. Okay. Another view of this could be just according to, you know, the access latency. And what we see here is our caches, our SRAMs, really they have very few nanoseconds, very few cycles to access them, but they're going to be really expensive and our density is going to be small. It's going to be in the megabyte kind of range. Okay, then we go much higher than that, and then we get to the DRAM, which can be, you know, probably hundreds of cycles in order to access it, but we can already get gigabytes over there, and we can see that on our board we'll already have DIMMs of these DRAMs that are connected to our chips. But remember, if we cannot put all of our memory on a chip within the SRAM, then our whole system becomes much more complex, because we have to have a board, we have to have a DDR controller that can interface with the DRAM, and we have to put that DRAM onto the same board with our SRAM, plus DRAM is very expensive in terms of memory because we have to refresh it all the time. Going further down, we have our high-performance storage, which would be our NAND flash, which is going to be one of these chips over here as well, and our hard disks, as we can see over here. They're very slow, but they have a ton of storage on them, and they're really cheap. Every bit is going to be very, very cheap. So we want to actually provide our compute units with the fastest available memory, that we can, but we can only do that to a certain point according to the density or, you know, the capacity of the memory we have. We can look over here at the cost versus the access time to the different these different hierarchies, and you can see that the CPU registers, they're very expensive, but they have, you know, a sub nanosecond type of access time. And then as we go down here, you know, the diameter of this is the log of the capacitor, so we get the caches, which we have more capacity, and they're again fast, but again they're really expensive. Then DRAM, storage class memory, SSDs, which are flash based hard drives, and then magnetic disks. Okay, and you can see over here kind of a scatter plot of these different types of memories with performance versus cost. So that was a really brief reminder overview of the memory hierarchy, and now we'll continue on looking into the different types of memory that we haven't discussed as of yet.